It's really incredible how every other area of science and technology is changing, but our animal testing approach has been defended for so long. Yeah? I mean, if you compare this to any other technology, think of the introduction of cars took mainly place in the 20s of the last century. That's when toxicology started and has not changed since. Yeah? Take a modern car compared to the T model of Ford. Take phones.
Just a moment.
We now use small mini computers with more power than they used for the space program. We start from the top and now let's go.
This is Thomas Hartung.
I'm Thomas Hartung. I'm professor at Johns Hopkins University, and I'm trying to change the way we are doing safety sciences, how we establish the safety of drugs and chemicals, and how we can do so with less animals.
He's here to help us take a look at how effective animal testing is. Is it a reliable predictor of human safety? For some of us who work in animal welfare and tend to like animals,
for example, me, we're a little biased when it comes to answering that question.
So, we asked Thomas and others what they think, and why, as a collective, we continue to rely on these practices.
We add toxicological tests, safety tests, whenever we have a problem. So, neither the regulators nor the regulated industry want liability problems.
Medicines and household chemicals can be dangerous.
So, they say animal testing has protected us so far, so we keep it. If you look a little bit closer, actually these animal methods are not that good. On average, only 2 of 3 experiments find a toxic substance.
What he's saying is that, on average, if you do the same kind of experiment on multiple animals of a particular species, they would only have a reaction to a substance that is toxic to humans 2 out of 3 times, or approximately 69% of the time.
So the question then, is that a good result?
We would not accept an alternative method which can only reproduce in 80% of the cases the animal experiment. We want 85-90%. Sometimes even 90% is not enough for regulators.
Regulators meaning, in many cases, the Food and Drug Administration, or any of the following agencies. They expect a higher result from newer approach methods.
So this tells me the doors should be wide open for new technologies, and not as an add-on, but as a replacement.
So what Thomas was able to demonstrate is what we've known anecdotally within our laboratory for decades, which is that the animal test is not very good at predicting itself.
Meaning, there are widely varying results when conducting the same set of tests on numerous animals of a particular species. This might put drug and product developers in a position to simply test on more animals because they're not getting the same result each time.
I'm Erin Hill. I'm the co-founder of the Institute for In Vitro Sciences. We're a nonprofit, This should be easy. This should be the easy part. We're a nonprofit laboratory-based organization offering non-animal testing methods. We were brought into this work early on by a lot of cosmetic companies that were interested in finding ways of assessing the safety of their products without using animals. If you look at something like the Dreh's eye irritation test, it's about as good as the flip of a coin.
The Dreh's eye irritation test, one that you might be familiar with the iconic visual of.
I was referring to the Dreh's test, the Dreh's rabbit eye test, which is an infamous test because it is considered nowadays cruel to animals. But we should also see it was introduced because there was a big scandal. In the late 30s, there was a cosmetic which was called lash lure in order to dye the lashes permanently. And it led to 5 cases of blindness. More than 3,000 women have been hurt by this, and 1 fatality. So this prompted the Food and Drug Administration.
Marking the first time that cosmetics were federally regulated.
It prompted their toxicologist, John Dreh's, to develop something to avoid that some of this happens again. And this created the rabbit eye test. The rabbit is actually a lousy model. The results are all over. We found around 500 chemicals which were corrosive, which means in some rabbit experiments, they really destroyed the eye. And in 20% of the cases, it was only a mild reaction. And in 10% of the cases, there was no reaction at all. So a substance which can really destroy the eye is only 70% reproducible. In 30% of the cases, you miss the dramatic effect.
Reproducibility is a big deal in this field, as it's what regulators like the FDA are looking for to determine the reliability of test results.
Such an assay should be replaced by something which is more reproducible, where you can really study also the human relevant effects.
The Institute for In Vitro Sciences has found a way to replace this test.
As we started doing this work about 20, 25 years ago, we were looking to identify in vitro test methods that could replace eye irritation or skin irritation tests, classically known as the Dreyse eye and skin tests conducted in rabbits, with using cell cultures and tissue reconstructions. And these are typically using human cells to become more human relevant.
According to them, it's more reliable and reproducible.
So the real problem then comes is when we're validating these new methods, when we're showing their reproducibility and their reliability, we're constantly being held back to this animal model that can't predict itself. But it's another step to get a regulatory agency to accept a method without tying it back to the animal model.
So it seems like we rely on these animal models because agencies are simply historically used to accepting them. Yet, by their own standards in accepting other methods, it seems like animal testing is not up to par.
These tests are not human relevant. We are not 70 kilogram rats. They're also too costly. It takes too long to get a result. It takes a company about 12 years and $2.4 billion on average to get something to the market. And most of the things are sold to the US. We are 4.3% of the world population, but we are 48% of the pharma market of the world. And 64% of the pharma market for drugs under patent. 64%. And this is why every company is only looking to the US market and its regulators, the FDA. They are setting the standards.
We spend a tremendous amount of time working with agencies here in the United States, moving away from animal testing. And I think we're coming to the day where we know, as the science evolves, we will not need it anymore. We can show confidence in those new methods.
I think that we have to be objective in the assessment what the animal test is delivering. We will not open up for new approaches if we are not willing to critically appraise the traditional methodologies.